Good day. My name is Michael Kirsch with LaRouchePack.com. I'm here with Paul Gallagher from Executive Intelligence Review. We're going to talk to you about the economic recovery plan of the United States. Everybody knows we're in quite a fix, and a lot more so since we've spoken with you last. But we have some ways to deal with this mess. And the first step we have going right now nationwide and in the Congress is a restoration of the Glass-Steagall Act. We're going to have Paul tell you about that in just a minute. But what are we going to do the day after Glass-Steagall? Are we going to have a banking system which, even though it has been restored to regulation, is able to facilitate growth of the economy overall? That's what we're going to answer here today. And as I'm speaking here as the principal author of the NAWAPA 21 Special Report, which you may be looking at in your email right now as you just clicked on a link that brought you to this video, or you may be on our page, our NAWAPA 21 project page. This is a plan which could achieve this kind of reorganization of the nation's finances in the same act that we revive our industry and rebuild the country. How those two things go together? We are demystifying here at LaRouchePack.com and EIR, and have been for quite some time, and we're working on this national plan, and it has some key elements which are all based in the legacy of the United States, the American system of political economy, or what Alexander Hamilton called the system of public credit, which was unique at the time and has been used again and again and again. And in Section 3 of the NAWAPA 21 Special Report, you'll find a way in which building this plan, what's involved in doing it, could restore that system of public credit, if it's done according to what we're going to be going through here today and in other videos. So let's just get into the discussion here by starting off the immediate first step, which is a restoration of Glass-Steagall.
Right, and that, as we have been stressing here, is in the Congress, and we're mobilizing nationally to get it passed. It's in the House with roughly 70 sponsors. It needs to be introduced into the Senate. It's very widely supported. And there's a breakout of national support among both union and non-unionized working constituencies, and also among business groups, including some community bankers. Glass-Steagall, as is very widely known, separates three fundamental categories of financial companies: commercial banks, investment banks and other securities dealing firms, and insurance companies. And it prevents holding companies from owning more than one kind of that. First thing that Glass-Steagall does is protect the commercial banks, which are those chartered in the what's now the Federal Reserve System of National Banks. It protects those commercial banks from speculation, including protecting them from their own speculation, since the commercial banks are where most of the money is. And by being drawn into the speculation casino over the last 15 years, those banks did so much lending into speculation and securities, they made the so-called shadow banking sector eventually bigger than the banking sector itself. It protects them from that. It prevents bailouts. It outlaws bailouts of financial activities based on securities, derivatives, the kind of activities that hedge funds, private equity funds carry out, and so forth. None of that can be bailed out. It's going to have a very decisive impact on the value, the overvalued value of those securities as soon as it's passed. And as an ongoing thing, Glass-Steagall also strongly regulates the commercial banks so that only a very tiny, tiny proportion of their assets or an equivalent may be invested in securities or in loans which support securities activity. And for the most part, it's limited to what are called bank-qualified securities, those issued by the federal government or guaranteed by the federal government, broadly speaking. So those are the basic elements of Glass-Steagall. It may be implemented over the course of a year in terms of the breakup of what are now non-allowable combinations of security casino activities with banks. But well before that year is done, starting immediately, the regulatory aspects of preventing this kind of securities speculation with deposits of bank customers and with premium income of insurance companies, that'll be underway.
That's a little bit longer than the bank holiday of FDR.
FDR did it in 11 days total.
Yeah.
And then legislated it as a 2 months later, May 6th, 1933, Glass-Steagall was passed, effectively permanently legislated what had been done in the 11 days of the bank holiday in March as an emergency series of measures.
So after we do something like that, what we lay out in the NAWAPA 21 Special Report is that immediately after Glass-Steagall, we have to resume U.S. government control over the currency, which is in the clause in the Article 1, Section 8, the power to coin money and fix the value thereof, which really means currency, not just hard coin, and fix the value thereof means regulate. And the way in which the United States has done that before has been through various measures, but largely the Treasury Department of the United States in relation with some kind of large bank of the United States, some kind of credit fund. Roosevelt did it with the RFC, and Lincoln, who was forced into a situation because the Rothschild and other banks had closed off all available credit, he had to employ the greenback as a measure in combination with then a process of trying to get back some kind of quasi-national banking system. If we want to channel the resources that are still existing after Glass-Steagall into some kind of plan, we have to realize that the United States government has as in its power to come forward and channel the creativity and the technology of the country as a whole towards some kind of great errand. And that's what NAWAPA 21 is, which is that, you know, we need right now, if we're gonna have a country, we need water, we need farms, we need to have this kind of resource that everybody knows is scarce.
And we need employment.
At the same time, to do that project, which is outlined here, will require a vast amount of machine production, material production, all the cement and steel, aluminum and copper, and then all the machine production, all of the major excavating, earth moving, other industrial machines for the pumps, the power stations, the rail systems, the transportation machines, well over 4 million jobs. And what the relation was between the Bank of the United States under Nicholas Biddle, he was a member of the Internal Improvement Society in Pennsylvania. And the greenbacks were not just printed out there, thrown out there for under Lincoln for just some random purpose. The banks were clearly going to use this to then loan for industry and agriculture. 2/3 of the loans that the Bank of the United States made, also between 1823 and 1832, were all for industry, agriculture, and investing in the capital stock of these different canal companies. So it's a realization that there's no fixed plan that is a formula for how you have to reinstate the credit system after Glass-Steagall. But what we lay out here is that every time we've done it, it's been according to using the way in which the Constitution was set up for essentially channeling the existing assets that are still around toward some kind of major program. And so what we're actually looking at is that we have the historical principles, but we have to rediscover exactly how to do it right now with the available debts that are going to exist after Glass-Steagall and other debt that we may want to create in such form as a greenback or foreign capital such as some of our national debt to other countries, and tie those debts to the creation of a future project. The first thing we can do right now as a discussion piece for today is the issue of channeling the existing assets of the country to purchase of bonds that would be directly used for the NAWAPA 21, authority that would be authorized by Congress that could sell its bonds, that would be authorized to sell bonds And in addition to an initial capital stock, that we opened a subscription from the government or perhaps the states, and then sell bonds for with the available money that people still have and investors to then use that. And I'd like to discuss some of that.
We received one question which it would be good to address right now, which is the functioning of the current so-called Federal Reserve or central banking system. Not to go into that in detail, but for the last 100 years, we have not had national banking. We have obviously, in Franklin Roosevelt and John F. Kennedy, presidents have found very powerful ways to direct credit into building up the country, producing productive employment on a large scale, building up our infrastructure. But the way the banking system has been regulated is that the government's debt, as it issues it, has gone through a certain small group of very large banks, national and international banks. And those banks have been regulated by the Federal Reserve, which has printed the money essentially with which those banks were buying the debt of the United States as it was issued. And the Federal Reserve has regulated its own printing and lending activity exclusively with regard to the health of those banks and not with regard to the health of the economy. I mean, we're in a situation now where banks are making record profits momentarily, you know, in these particular few quarters, while the economy is completely tanking.
You can't go down to your local Federal Reserve branch and get a loan for a big construction project.
Yeah, those
you could have done that with the national
bank. With the national bank, because in the national bank, rather than you having this kind of circle where the Fed, the Federal Reserve is servicing the needs of the big banks, and the big banks are buying the debt of the federal government, and in many cases, no money can leak out into the rest of the economy because of carry trades and so forth. Rather than that, you have a national bank. You may have a fund such as the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, which is simply borrowing money on the credit of the United States and putting it into very specific, productive, large-scale investments like the RFC did. Or you may have, in addition, U.S. Treasury actually buying some of the debt of that authority or corporation, that fund. You may have it issuing new Treasury debt directly into that to build up the capital of that fund, and you may have it also depositing government revenues in that fund and inviting private investors as well to invest. Then you have a national bank whose whole purpose is to take these concentrations of capital and put them into projects like the North American Water and Power Alliance, which really build employment, which really transform infrastructure and take the country forward. And this essentially, the way Lyndon LaRouche has put this, is it's three actions in one. Some of these actions take longer and last longer than others, but it's three actions in one. The immediate implementation, re-implementation of Glass-Steagall to end the bailouts and protect commercial banking. The creation of credit through such a national fund as the RFC, capital budgeting, or preferably through a new national bank, and the investment of that credit in the real development of the productivity of the economy, such as water management on a continental scale, creation of 4 to 6 million jobs. These are really one action which has to be taken, but there are three parts to it, and some of the parts last a lot longer than others.
Well, the discussion is so vast, we're not going to get through it all today, but how these things worked, how the TBA worked, as you just said, how the RFC, I think that the point on the difference between the RFC and the National Bank, why it would really be good to do a Bank of the United States now, is because, as I started out with the point I was trying to make, we have so little left of actual real industry. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of crazy financial stuff, but real industry, real assets, that would allow us to fix it at a point, concentrate it, because everybody can deposit into these branches of the bank. So anybody's useful wealth that's still around can immediately be put into lending as part of a big project. The RFC was not quite like that, right? The RFC was raising, borrowing money from other people and then being able to lend on that amount. But it was not a place where you could both, either private investors could subscribe to its capital, nor could any individual company just make deposits, nor could the government's own all of its collected taxes be in the bank. But I think it would be useful to just go through quickly, how did the TVA actually find its capital to invest in all the great dams and other projects that were done, and the fertilizer plants? And then how we're thinking about this now, jiggering the initial charter of that for the NAWAPA 21 Act.
Well, I think you could say more, but what you're referring to is that Franklin Roosevelt, not having a national bank and not having, coming in the midst of a very, very advanced crisis with mass unemployment and all the banks closed, was not in a situation where politically he could start with the construction of a national bank. Lacking that, he created some very powerful authorities, of which the TVA was the best known, and the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, by far the largest and most expansive in its investments. As John F. Kennedy said in many speeches in 1962, which are in your film, where he strongly motivates water management projects on a large scale all over the west of this continent. JFK continually pointed to the TVA and said that this is what everyone who comes here from other countries wants to see, is the Tennessee Valley. How was this done? Where an authority was created with the ability to raise capital both from the Reconstruction Finance Corporation lending it money and also by issuing its own bonds, and which was enabled, empowered not only to build certain infrastructure for which it's famous, power plants, dams and reservoirs controlling the Mississippi, the Tennessee River, and so on, but also was empowered to change the culture of poverty throughout that whole area, to educate, to build libraries, to operate mobile libraries, to assist local and state governments in really changing the way in which they govern those areas. It was able to monitor on a very, very close basis at all times the needs for water and water management throughout that whole area. And it became the lever for making the poorest area of the entire country into temporarily at least the most productive. And it was an astonishing accomplishment. And it was based on its own bonding authority, that is, it was in effect a large capital budget, which was also a federal capital budget, which was assisted by another one, namely the Reconstruction Finance Corporation. And between them, they leveraged a great deal of capital, both public and private.
Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution, nowhere does it say these powers shall not be executed by the use of a corporation. And these corporations that were created under that authority. And these are corporations that are created to be responsible for these powers of the Congress that needed to be done at that time,
general
as you
welfare,
just said,
right.
The general welfare. And this is really what the question is, again, I think in this case, is that the credit of the government here is not seen as a greenback creation in the TVA. Mm-hmm. It's not clear exactly to us how much of the RFC's bond sales were marketed by the Treasury, you know, and backed by the credit of the U.S.
All
that's
of them
explicitly
were backed by
right.
The Treasury, yeah.
Well, that's clear to us, but it's not clear exactly how many the Treasury actually bought as a basis of its own just straight creation of credit, or exactly how the Federal Reserve at that time maybe how much the Federal Reserve was lending to the banks, allowing the banks to buy the bonds of the RFC, and therefore, in effect, being a quasi-greenback. But the important thing is that it's the intention of the government to say we're going to do something like this. It's the intention of the government to say we shall act to guide the economy toward carrying out our objective as a nation. we elect a government, and that's a whole other discussion of why we have a government, not just a bunch of private corporations. But the issue is, it's the intention of the government to set up a special corporation for the specific task, and say that they shall be authorized to sell bonds that are all backed by the U.S. So it's as though it's the government's own bond sales channeled through a specific intention, an arm, and there's absolutely no problem with doing that. The issue is, now, in this case, with the TVA, where it's raising money that exists. And even in the midst of that depression, there were investors that were holding on to money that could then be bought, and that the credit of the government made that possible. In this case, now today, we look around and we see very small, few assets left, but there's a number of things which we could do. And I'd like to discuss one point, which I think many governors out there and other cities would find appealing, which is that the NAWAPA 21 Authority, which would be a much larger institution than the TVA, and would have a larger initial capital stock,
let's just clarify that, because we're using initials, that you mean the authority created to implement, to construct the North American Water and Power Alliance plan.
Yes.
Right? When you say NAWAPA Authority.
Well, in the context of a national banking system, that's going to be the relation between those two is a separate discussion. But we look at how we can facilitate this whole, or reconstructing a national credit system. Part of the plan could be that the states, which are now sitting on paying interest, sinking any kind of, well, they're all in debt. I mean, you hear it all the time, and the actual shortfalls and so on. We could take the debt off the books and allow the states to use that debt as an asset rather than just sinking funds into it. And this authority that would be set up could use the future value of the debt, the intention to pay, which is how Hamilton founded the country also, as an asset in which to purchase all these kinds of things. So the payment, the interest payments on this debt, and that the fact that it's going to be paid, could be facilitated by increase of tax income and all the economic activity in the state and in the districts. And with the immediate and anticipated economic activity of the NAWAPA plan, each state now can generate a surplus and actually tend to its own infrastructure, because now, instead of financing this debt, the initial capital stock of the NAWAPA plan, which we're thinking a 10 billion, 20 billion, 10 billion by each Canada and the United States, could also be subscribed by the states. This would be one part of it. You have a separate part of it, which I think. But the states could subscribe to that initial capital stock and also purchase bonds of this authority, work out an agreement by purchasing it with this, what is now a debt, but would actually then be an asset.
Yeah, if we look at the NAWAPA plan as a whole, on which you've done this whole design in the report, North American Water and Power Alliance involves construction, in many cases major construction, in at least 33 of the federal states of the United States, and in Alberta and Saskatchewan and in British Columbia, power construction on a large scale, and even to a certain extent in Mexico. But these states now are in a situation, and they all, every governor knows this, the only way they've been able to invest in any infrastructure has been a program called Build America Bonds, which are bonds which the states issue, but the Federal Reserve, the federal government insures the payment of interest on them, and they're tax-free. This is a thimble-sized program. It's been doled out in tiny drops, and every governor knows that this is the only way that states in recent years have been able to invest in any infrastructure of their own. What is possible with this kind of North American Water and Power Authority is that the issuance of bonded debt of this authority becomes blended with the issuance of new debt by the states. Obviously, in every one of those states where federal project construction is going on, the states will also have matching work to do, water distribution work and many other kinds of matching work to do, which will create employment and productivity for them. And therefore, they should be able to invest in the authority, and the authority should be able to purchase their existing debt and also new debt, so that they would be free, their credit would be freed up for more investment of their own. This is essential because the states now are frozen; they're virtually bankrupt from this standpoint, as
right.
well as having budget crises of revenue crises. They're bankrupt from the bonded infrastructure standpoint.
So that could be another thing. The NAWAPA 21 authority, whatever capital it gets from others, it could also, what you're saying, it could buy the bonds. And
newly issued state debt or state debt which is maturing and being rolled over, they could, the authority could buy, and that would, in effect, free up more state bonding ability for investments of their own.
Right.
And they'd be wanting to make investments right along with the water management and power and other construction investments that NAWAPA was making.
Yeah, the main thing is that the existing debts and financial assets, however which way it is, however which way we do it, whether it's the authority itself taking the books off the states or the states subscribing, it's a way, in whether it's the capital stock or the bond sales of the authority, the key point is the linking of what is seemingly a monetary debt and linking it to the future creation of wealth, which now that becomes a credit debt. And what's circulating in the present as the basis for the loans of banks and now an increased actual currency, not this funny currency that was going on now, but an actual currency that reflects that future creation of wealth, is a reflection of the future value of the debt, not the monetary value of the debt. So however you do it, the foundation of it rests clearly in the United States founding. And anybody who says you can't do something like this and you're just playing a financial magic, again, the point is you're channeling the resources of the country to a future intent. And the resources of the country are the resources of an actual point is the nation. The word reveals itself. The government here has a place. And any of the logic of the accountants and the private investors who say we must now take the collapse of the euro and the collapse of the United States as evidence that we should just get rid of any ability of any sovereign nation state to govern its finances is not only historically illiterate, as we demonstrate in our report here, but is acting as an agent against the sovereign power of any nation state. And right now in the United States, we have a big responsibility. And we have the basis for it historically to do this kind of thing. Hamilton did it, which is my point I was going to say. Anybody who thinks you can't do this, look, buddy, this is how the nation was founded. And you wouldn't be sitting around unless Robert Morris and Hamilton had actually taken what was a monetary debt and made it almost the entire capital stock of the Bank of the United States, and all the lending was done on that. So we could do something again now, and this is introduction here, and we'll be discussing this more, willing to discuss anything, questions that you have, or set up a meeting on how to initiate this further. So unless you have any final comments, Paul.
No, good. Thank you. Just to back to where we started, this is what we're capable of doing. To open the door to do that, we have to rescue the national credit from being completely committed to bailouts, not only bailouts of banks here, bailouts of banks all over Europe, which are about to start again. We have to rescue the national credit, bar it from going into those bailouts so that we can use it. That's why Glass-Steagall restoration opens the door to national credit and to really building up the country and employment.
All right, thanks. We'll talk to you later. Till next time.